The history of Toyota in the World Rally Championship is a journey from a newcomer to one of the leaders in the world of rallying. Since its debut in the 1970s, Toyota's conquered some of the toughest tracks, showcasing power, reliability, and engineering excellence. However, in Toyota's sporting history, there was the Celica model with the ST-205 index, which appeared in 1994 and became the center of a scandal, the consequences of which Toyota had to deal with for a long time. And today, I'll tell you how it happened. Group B rally cars had a short but very bright history. Their rise, like the rise of everything crazy in the world of motorsport, was in the 1980s. Their decline, however, was very swift and tragic. In 1986, immediately after several serious accidents, Group B was deemed too dangerous for rallying. From 1987 onwards, the premier category in the rally world became the safer, heavier, and slower Group A cars. Unlike their brutal predecessors, Group A cars were much closer to production models, retaining their body panels, layout, and thus all the associated shortcomings. While rally drivers would have undoubtedly preferred to be behind the wheel of something faster, fans of fast road cars benefited from Group A rules. The tie to production models encouraged car manufacturers to produce powerful, fun, and often all-wheel drive sedans and hatchbacks, which could later be used as a basis for designing a full-fledged racing car. Despite the fact that the power of Group A rally cars rarely exceeded 300 horsepower, within a few years, they began to complete special stages in times comparable to the 600 horsepower monsters of Group B. Eventually, they even started to go faster. This was achieved primarily due to advancements in suspension and tires, resulting in significantly better handling and road grip. Lancia, with its Delta, was the best prepared for the new era of Group A and became the dominant force for several years. The champion Peugeot exited rallying, and the new Group A Audis couldn't provide significant competition to the Italians. However, the Japanese managed to do so. At the turn of the 80s and 90s, rallying attracted Japanese brands like a magnet, and at one point, factory teams from Mazda, Nissan, Mitsubishi, Subaru, and Toyota competed in the World Championship. But it was Toyota that managed to pose the most serious challenge to the seemingly unbeatable Lancia. Rally cars based on Toyota have been built for quite some time, and the previous generation of the Celica even achieved a few stage victories. However, the rear-wheel drive Toyota Celica Twin Cam Turbo could not pose a serious challenge to the all-wheel drive monsters of Peugeot, Lancia, and Audi. Everything changed at the end of the 80s, when the new, fourth-generation Celica entered the rally stages. Equally important, in 1989, Toyota was joined by the young Spanish rally champion, Carlos Sainz Sr., who, a year later, became the world champion behind the wheel of Toyota. However, the manufacturer's championship still remained with Lancia, meaning the mission could not be considered fully accomplished. The new, fifth-generation Celica was supposed to continue what had been started.
Check out the super styling. The dual mode four wheel steering. Go kick in 10 speaker super live sound system.
In its basic configuration, it was a front wheel drive coupe with a modest engine producing just over 100 horsepower. However, thanks to Group A homologation rules, this car had much more impressive versions. This included the Celica GT4 Carlos Sainz Edition with a turbocharged engine, all-wheel drive, an aggressive body kit, and wider wheel arches. Its rally version debuted on the stages in 1992, bringing Carlos Sainz his second world championship title. From that point on, Toyota drivers were unstoppable. In 1993, the world champion in a Celica was Finnish driver Juha Kankkonen, and in 1994, Frenchman Didier Auriol. Interestingly, before getting behind the wheel of a rally car, Didier worked as an ambulance driver, perhaps the fastest ambulance driver in the world. But the 1994 title was not easily won by Auriol and Toyota. By that time, Lancia had exited rallying, but new competitors emerged. Ford with the new Escort, Mitsubishi with the second generation Lancer Evolution, and Subaru with the latest Impreza. The drivers of the Subaru were Carlos Sainz, who came from Toyota, and the promising Scotsman Colin McRae. For his reckless driving at the start of his career, Colin earned the nickname McCrash. However, over time, the nickname was remembered less frequently, especially since, if McRae wasn't in a ditch, he was generally fighting for victory. In 1994, Colin won twice, one win ahead of Carlos Sainz. It was clear that the rising Subaru would provide Toyota with an even more serious challenge the following year. At the wheel of the Impreza was possibly the fastest driver pair of its time, and the car itself, adorned with the now-famous livery featuring three fives, looked more confident than the Celica on any surface. It was crucial for Toyota to respond to this. The answer came in the form of the updated Celica with the ST-205 index. The car received even more aerodynamic shapes and some technical upgrades. Among these was the latest anti-lag system of that time. Its purpose was to address the main drawback of any turbo engine, the slow throttle response at low revs. The frequent machine gun-like popping of the exhaust on liftoff is a side effect of the anti-lag system. To explain where this comes from, we need to start with the basics of how a turbo engine works. The key element is the turbocharger, which forces air into the cylinder. The higher the pressure in the intake manifold, the more air enters the cylinder, which increases the amount of fuel burned and thus boosts the engine's power. However, the compressor doesn't spin on its own, but is driven by the exhaust gases from the engine, which turn the turbine. This creates a feedback loop. The more exhaust gas pressure, the higher the turbine's RPM. The more air enters the cylinder, and the more power the engine produces. The problem is that this power is not available immediately. There's always a delay between pressing the throttle, igniting the fuel, and spinning up the turbo. This delay is called turbo lag. To overcome it, the turbo needs to be kept spinning, even when the throttle was closed. Engineers solved this problem by burning additional fuel not just in the cylinder, but also outside it, in the exhaust manifold. This was achieved through adjustments to the timing of ignition and valve openings. The ignited fuel outside the cylinders would literally shoot out with bangs and flashes, but along the way, it kept the turbine's RPM high, meaning the car was ready to shoot forward almost instantly, right after the throttle was pushed. However, to outpace the accelerating competitors, this was no longer enough. All attempts to make the Celica faster ran into the shortcomings of the standard body. The car's long and wide dimensions with large overhangs made it less maneuverable compared to the more compact rally cars of the new generation. Additionally, due to its design, Celica drivers had long complained about poor visibility. While Toyota had previously been saved by its powerful engine, in the lead-up to 1995, the International Automobile Federation took away even that advantage. The size of the restrictor washer, which limited air intake for turbocharging for all Group A cars, was legislatively reduced from 36 to 34 millimeters. It may sound like a minor change, but these few millimeters were enough to level the playing field, choking the most powerful and high-revving engines. Even before the championship began, Toyota's engineers realized that with the new regulations, their car had no chance whatsoever. After the first six stages, the team had only one win to their name, a hard-fought victory by Didier Auriol in Corsica. His teammate, Juha Kankkonen, didn't win a single race. However, thanks to incredible consistency, he managed to lead the championship. The seventh and penultimate stage of the World Championship was set to take place on the asphalt roads of Spain. Besides Kankkonen and Auriol, only two Subaru drivers, Colin McRae and Carlos Sainz, had a realistic chance for the title. To everyone's surprise, after the first day, the lead was held by Juha Kankkonen in the Toyota, which had never been particularly strong on asphalt. Local hero Carlos Sainz in the Subaru was 22 seconds behind. Following him was Armin Schwarz in another Toyota, while Colin McRae was in fourth place. No one, including the competitors, understood what was happening and where Toyota's speed had come from. The FIA technical inspectors were also puzzled and, just in case, took the used turbos from Kankkonen and Auriol's cars for closer examination. Perhaps even at that moment, Toyota understood what was coming. So, everything that later happened with their cars might have been part of a show orchestrated by the team's management. On the second day of the rally, Kankkonen extended his lead over Sainz to nearly a minute. His Toyota was flying over the roads, carrying the Finnish driver towards the first asphalt stage win. But then this happened. A navigator error by Nikki Grist sent Kankinen into a ditch. Soon after, Armin Schwarz's second Celica also retired due to rear suspension damage from an accident. Only Didier Auriol, who was in third place behind Sainz and McRae, remained on the stage. However, he didn't hold this position for long. The issue wasn't limited to just an open hood. Auriol's car was rapidly losing pace due to transmission problems. Just before the finish, the team even asked the Frenchman to retire. However, this could not diminish or delay the disgrace that awaited Toyota in the very near future. Meanwhile, after Kankinen's retirement, the battle for victory was between Subaru teammates Carlos Sainz and Colin McRae. A win for either could make him the championship leader before the final rally in Britain. Sainz was ahead of McRae by 8 seconds. The team decided that the driver should finish in this order. Perhaps a win for the Spaniard on home soil would bring more PR benefits, or maybe the management simply wanted both cars to score as many points as possible for the manufacturer's championship. The fight between the two teammates could easily end in an error and a retirement, especially if one of your drivers is Colin McRae. Therefore, team boss David Richards strictly forbade McRae from attacking. In response, McRae pushed the pace to the limit and not only caught up with Sainz, but also pulled 8 seconds ahead of him during the third day. The tension between the team and the driver reached such a level that Subaru staff even went out onto the road and signaled with their hands for McRae to slow down. McRae, of course, did not slow down. He later said that lifting his foot off the throttle might have made him lose concentration and make a mistake. Therefore, he finished the rally ahead of Sainz. McRae demonstratively stopped just short of the final time control point, for which he was immediately penalized with a 1 minute time penalty, dropping him to second place.
Yeah, but we've had the book in a minute late now, so we're second.
So this was categoric team orders?
Yeah, that's what it was. I don't agree with it, but that's the way it is. I won the rally. Why? We're fighting for the championship. Why should I have to finish second? Hey?
Now both Subaru teammates had 70 points each before the final stage of the season, but the scandal unfolding behind the scenes overshadowed even Subaru's strange team tactics. After a thorough examination of Toyota's turbocharger, FIA technical inspection discovered a hidden mechanism that allowed air to bypass the restrictor washer and enter the turbo. The mechanism was activated only while the turbine was running and was cleverly disguised when the turbo was removed for inspection. Thanks to the additional air intake, the engine's power increased by about 50 horsepower, which was a significant boost to the original 300 horsepower. Max Mosley, president of the International Automobile Federation, remarked that in all his 30 years in the sport, he had never seen such an elegant and cunning technical solution. However, there were no leniencies for the technical deceit. The team and its drivers were stripped of all points earned during the 1995 season. Additionally, Toyota was banned from participating in the World Rally Championship for the entire following year. This was the harshest penalty in the history of rallying, and even competitors did not support it. This meant that the following year, only 3 factory teams would remain in the World Championship: Subaru, Ford, and Mitsubishi. The final stage of the season in the UK took place without Toyota. Colin McRae clinched victory from Carlos Sainz, becoming the first British World Rally Champion. This time, there were no team orders. By then, Carlos Sainz had announced his departure from Subaru, so the team bosses had no reason to support him in the title chase. Subsequently, Toyota, having served its punishment, returned to the championship with a new WRC spec Corolla. Its drivers were Carlos Sainz and Didier Auriol. In 1999, they jointly helped the team win the Manufacturers' Championship. Today, Toyota competes in the World Championship with a new Yaris Rally 1 model. Colin McRae came close to repeating his 1995 success several times, but the first title remained his only one. However, this hardly reflects the respect he commanded in the world of motorsport and beyond. For many, McRae became a true symbol of rallying, not least due to the Colin McRae Rally video game series, on which more than one generation of players grew up. Unfortunately, in 2007, Colin died in a helicopter crash while piloting a private helicopter in Scotland. At that time, he had been out of rallying for a year, but was still working on his return to the World Championship.
And six right, and 5 right plus opens, and 6 left 50, K 5 left opens, 30, 6 right into left tightens the long 5, opens, don't...